Good evening, and welcome to the regularly scheduled board meeting, Tuesday, January 15th, 2013. The time is now 7:04. Item number one, call to order, roll call, and we do have a quorum. Item number two and three, pledge of allegiance to the U.S. and Texas flags and the invocation. And this evening, we do have students from Fred Booth Elementary who will be assisting us. I'd like to ask Brandon Ryan Farias to please stand. Today, proudly representing Fred Booth Elementary is 10-year-old fourth grader Brandon Ryan Farias. He's the son of Rene and Mindy Farias. He has three sisters, Brandy, Bethany, and Beverly Farias, all of whom are former and present Fred Booth alumni. Brandon is a current GT student. He has been recognized for A honor roll in grades first through third. Top student in first and second grade. Perfect attendance in second and third grade. He participated in this year's science fair and is currently a member of Fred Booth's chess team. With his love for math, he has participated in Math Olympics for the past 2 years and has been recognized for being part of Fred Booth's gold rating both years. Brandon's hobbies include, but are not limited to, drawing, basketball, and playing video games. He wants to be a lawyer when he grows up, and although he may not see it, he brings lots of joy and laughter to those around him. He is quite an entertainer and takes pride in making you laugh and smile. Also joining us this evening, we have Janie Ann Longoria. Janie's a fourth grader at Fred Booth Elementary and daughter of Juanita Rojas, PE teacher at Fred Booth Elementary. She has successfully attained top achiever status for her class every term. From kindergarten up to present date, at this tender age of 10 years of age, Janie is already displaying very strong self-discipline and academic skills. She's recently been nominated to be tested for gifted and talented. Her accomplishments, though minimal, demonstrate her strong intellectual abilities and great leadership skills. At this year's Math Olympics, Janie and her team rose to the occasion, delivered a great performance, and received the gold medal. In her school, Janie is currently the highest Mayan reading book count reader as per Fred Booth librarian. Furthermore, she has been actively involved in Marathon Kids, takes guitar lessons in her school's fine arts program. Her hobbies include drawing, playing on her scooter. And there you have both students, Janie and Brandon. If I can please ask everyone to rise for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to the Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
Please remain standing for the invocation.
Please bow your heads. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this evening for your blessing and help as we gather in this meeting. We pray for guidance for the matters at hand. We ask that you help us to encourage one another. Please clearly guide us to conduct our work with a spirit of compassion and understanding. Lord, we ask that you bless our community in this hour and hereafter. We ask this in your holy name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. I'd also like to ask this evening for the principal, Ms. Mary Alice Leal, if she's present, please stand, and the parents of these students for allowing them to participate this evening as well. Moving on to item number four, special recognitions. Mr. Limon?
Thank you, Madam President. School Board Recognition Month, January 2013. The following proclamation: whereas the mission of public schools is to meet the diverse educational needs of all children and to empower them to become competent, productive contributors to a democratic society in an ever-changing world. And it's whereas local school board members are committed to children and believe that all children can be successful learners and that the best education is tailored to the individual needs of the child. And whereas local school board members work closely with parents, educational professionals, and other community members to create the educational vision we want for our students. And whereas local school board members are responsible for ensuring the structure and provide a solid foundation for our school system. And whereas local school board members are strong advocates for public education, are responsible for communicating the needs of the school district to the public and the public expectations to the district. Therefore, I, Antonio G. Limon, Superintendent of Schools, do hereby declare my appreciation to the members of the San Benito CISD Board of Trustees and proclaim the month of January 2013 as School Board Recognition Month in San Benito, Texas. Congratulations to our school board members. I'll turn it over to Celia for the rest of the program.
Mr. Limon, and it gives us great honor to be here before you tonight recognizing our Board of Trustees this evening. We have representation from all of our campuses here this evening, and we'd like to get started with the school board members first. The first one on the list to get recognition is Ms. Fatima Huerta. And Ms. Huerta, if I can get you to come up to the front and remain up at the front, and then we'll call the students so that they can do the presentations. We have student representatives conducting the presentations from Angela Jerusalial Elementary, Marisa L. Martinez and Italy Pedraza. And from Frank Roberts Elementary, Juliet Hernandez and Alexander Emilio Avila. And from Rangerville Elementary, we have Adalia Garcia and Noah Martel. The next honoree on the list is Mr. Julian Huerta. If we can get all the board members to remain up at the front, Ms. Huerta, till we get finished with the presentation. That way y'all can kind of be in the spotlight for a while. Mr. Julian Huerta is the next honoree. We have some campuses doing the presentation this evening. Fred Booth Elementary. We have Brandon Ryan Farias that's here to do the presentation. We had another student on the list, Cassandra Ramirez. I don't believe they were able to make it. And another student also scheduled, Eric Villa. We did have situations with the weather that may have prevented some of the children from attending this evening. But at any rate, from Fred Booth Elementary, we have Brandon Ryan Farias, who you met earlier. And we have Janie Longoria, if you'd like to join Brandon, do the presentation as well. And Janie Longoria is making her way up to the front, so we'll let her make her way up to the front. Since she was able to stay behind for just a few moments. From Landrum Elementary, I'd like to introduce Noah Carrizales and Evelyn Hernandez. From Riverside Middle School, we have Ivan Salinas and Brian Manzanares. Thank you, students. The next honoree on the list is Mr. Oscar Medrano, who could not be present this evening. So, Mr. Limon, would you do the honors and accept the awards on his behalf? From La Paloma Elementary, Daniela Gonzalez and Gabriela E. Lopez. from Gateway Academy, Harley Garcia and Ana Olguin. And from San Benito High School, Victor M. Guerra and Liana Gonzalez. Thank you, students. The next board member on the list scheduled for recognition is Mr. Hector G. Leal. And we have three campuses doing the honors. From Dr. Raul Garza Jr. Elementary, we have student representatives Audrey Garza and Benito Anaya. From La Encantada Elementary, Angel Flores and Audrey Cadriel. And from Joe Calandrid Positive Redirection Center, we have Larry Limon and George Ramirez Jr. Thank you, students. We move on with our officers on the board. Secretary June Aguilera. And we have three campuses doing the honors this evening, from Dr. C.M. Cash Elementary, Tabitha Lafuente and Jeremy Sauceda. From Sullivan Elementary, Brianna Treviño and Desiree Treviño. From Miller Jordan Middle School, Madeline Rose Hernandez and Joshua Nicholas Jackson. The next officer, Vice President Ana Cruz, and she's not with us at this moment. So Mr. Superintendent of Schools, Antonio G. Limon, will accept on her behalf. We have two campuses doing the honors this evening, from Judge Oscar de la Fuente Elementary, Ryan Isaiah Rodriguez and Haley Jane Rodriguez. From Veterans Memorial Academy, Marisa Maldonado and Savannah Ray Arellano. And we have our school board president, Ms. Ileana G. Rodriguez. And we have two campuses doing the honors, Ed Downs Elementary, Kelly Martinez, and Hannah Trunell. From Berta Cavaza Middle School, student representatives Andrew L. Claudio Jr. and Travis L. Treviño. Thank you, students. At this time, I'd like to recognize parents of these fine students that came to join us this evening in celebration of School Board Recognition Month. Parents, if you're in the audience, please stand and be recognized at this time. And thank you for bringing your children. And thank you to our San Benito CISD Board of Trustees for everything that you all do for our students and our school district and our staff. We appreciate it. I'd like to give a special thanks to Director of Bands, Mr. Willie Perez, and San Benito High School Principal Delia Weaver for graciously allowing us to have entertainment this evening. And the entertainment is none other than Flamenco's Quartet under the direction of Albert Ortiz and Jorge Mascorro. and also San Benito High School's jazz band under the direction of Mark Perea. So thank you all for being here this evening. Also, a special thanks to Veterans Memorial Academy Principal Ms. Teresa Cervellon and her staff for allowing us to host tonight's event and for all the assistance that we received this evening, as well as Child Nutrition Program staff for their assistance and all of our staff members as well. So now we begin with the entertainment. And then we will break for a short reception.
On behalf of your Board of Trustees, we'd like to thank all those present and the entire community of San Benito for their unconditional support and for providing us these great performances. Parents and students, thank you once again. It is our pleasure to serve San Benito, and our goal continues to be that of ensuring the success of every child. So again, on behalf of your Board of Trustees, a great big thank you to everyone in attendance, as well as those that could not make it. We just want to say thank you. At this time, we're going to go ahead and move on to item number 5, break for reception. The time is 7:41, so we should resume back at about 8 o'clock, about 15, 20 minutes. We're going to go ahead and move on to item number 6, Superintendent's Report. Mr. Limon.
Thank you, Madam President. At this time, I would like to inform the board of some of the trips that have been scheduled. We have the Special Education Central Office Special Olympics Bowling Team, the State Winter Games in Austin, January the 31st through February the 3rd. San Benito High School and Veterans Memorial Academy, the College Assistant Migrant Program, or the CAMP program as it's known, St. Andrews University and the University of Texas, the Migrant Graduation Enhancement Program. That'll be February the 8th through February the 10th, 2013 in Austin. Have San Benito High School, the TAFE Club, Future Educators, the State Leadership Competition in San Antonio at the Grand Hyatt Hotel, February the 17th through February the 19th. San Benito High School and Veterans Memorial Academy, the Migrant Student Seminar on Government and Current Events, March the 10th through the 15th in the nation's capital. We also have our scheduled showcase presentations for tonight. At this time, I will ask Mr. Tim Moon from Ed Downs Elementary to come forward and to showcase his campus.
Presses the on button for the video. We have a very special, first of all, it's almost past my bedtime. And so I will move this along as quickly as possible. We do have a very special group of kids at Ed Downs. They produce a weekly newscast. It's called Ed TV. And we decided to let them take this project on. And so what you're going to see is a student-produced, student-edited, student-acted, student-everything project. It's really a little different, and I think you'll enjoy it. So let's put the show on.
My name is Jessica. This is the Auxiliary School Ed Downs. Here are some highlights of our school. We hope you enjoy them.
Just by Jordan Andrew.
I am Marco the Talking Corn Dog.
We are going to interview some kids.
My question is, why do you kids like chess?
Your Ghetto taught me when I was in kindergarten, and I started being real good at it. My sister taught me too. And I became real good.
Chess, because it is a very fun subject after school, and you get to get snacks.
We are videotaping some kids playing chess.
I've been coaching Ed Downs for 12 years. I started in 2001. My favorite memory would be that the year that we won state, 2007, so we're co-state champions. I do this because I really think it helps you guys become better people.
Mrs. Demas's Class by Reese and Kelly. Ms. Demas is one of the most fun teachers of all.
I'm going to show you a video of Ms. Demas's class doing math.
Ready.
Mrs. Demas's class is doing a time test on the sevens.
5 minutes.
Megan is happy because she finished.
Zachary is happy because he also finished too.
This is Ms. Demas's hamster.
This is Chubbs. He lives in Ms. Demas's class.
Why do you like the hamsters?
Because it's chubby and it's cute.
What does the hamster teach you?
It teaches us about, like, nature, climbs on the cake.
What do you like about the hamster?
That he's chubby, he looks funny, and he looks funny when he gets on his exercise wheel. He teaches us about living things.
These are some children telling us about the ornaments on the Christmas tree and the pictures of candles and turkeys on the wall.
Why did you make the ornaments on the tree?
Because we're learning about three-dimensional shapes, and it's a cube.
What was special about making the cubes?
What was special about making the cubes is that we got to put a wish inside a cube.
How do you get the answers to the candles?
How we get the answers is we get on our agenda and there's a multiplication chart and we use it and it was really fun and there's a multiplication chart.
Is that the only one you have done?
No, that's not the only one we've done. We've done a turkey, but since then we've been learning more multiplication facts, so we really don't use our agenda anymore.
Miss class. By George and Audrey.
How do the iPads benefit the kids?
The students are using the iPad to reinforce concepts that they're learning, such as rhyming, number recognition, alphabet recognition.
We videotaped some kids using an iPad. These two kids are learning how to spell on iPads. We videotaped some other fun stuff in her classroom. These kids are reading about cars and trucks. These two kids are on Starfall learning the letter G. There are more fun things in her classroom. Call the office to schedule time to check out Ms. Baeza's room.
Special events by Marcus and Nate.
These students woke up at 5:30 a.m. to go to Laguna Descosa when it was dark.
The students put up bird mist nets that the birds can't see to capture the birds so they can collect data on them.
On the ecosystem tour, students studied the interactions between organisms in the area. The fifth grade students who went on the sea turtle tour learned about turtles, fed them, and cleaned their pools.
The students who launched ball rockets developed experiments on rockets. Schlierbahn is an award for fifth graders for doing their work all year long.
Other field trips we take are to the Ballet Folklorico, McAllen and Harlingen Museums, the Brownsville Courthouse, the Marine Lab in South Padre, and the Santa Ana Wildlife Refuge.
Here are some other things we do and participate in at Ed Downs. The Science Fair, Math Olympics, UIL, the Multimedia Competition, the Fire Prevention Contest, Honor Choir, the 5th Grade Promotion Ceremony, fundraisers, group counseling, the 5th graders say the pledge every morning, PTO t-shirts, end of the year carnival, the AR party, Relay for Life, Toys for Tots, collecting canned goods for the food pantry, and collecting money for loaves and fishes in Harlingen.
P.E. by Reese and Kelly.
This is Mr. Zapata's Kinder P.E. class playing. These kids are on the playground twice a week.
They look like they are having fun.
Here is a video of Mr. Zapata teaching. These kids are warming up so they don't get hurt when they are playing.
These kids are doing crazy jacks.
Here's a video of Mr. Zapata teaching the children how to play kickball.
They're picking the kids to start. He's teaching the kids about kickball. These kids seem to get it and are playing really well. And for first graders, these kids are really good at kicking, but not as good as coaches at teaching. Go coach! Yay!
PE does not only help with the development of the mind and body, but it also helps with the development of behavior and character.
Robotics by Marcus Galvan and Nathaniel Amaya.
The program was put together to teach kids problem-solving skills, and what happens is about 6 to 10 kids get selected by their teachers, and they get to build robots and then program those robots to achieve a certain challenge or a certain goal. If they reach that goal, then they get on the Wall of Fame.
The students who are in EDRA have to complete challenges. Every time they complete a challenge, the next challenge will be hard.
Bye-bye.
These are the students who have participated in EDRA. This is what happened to the other robot.
Bye, yo.
Discovery Lab and E-Lab by Mauricio Padilla Jr.
In the Discovery Lab, students are allowed to explore scientific concepts using materials and tools. And what we do then is we take any data that's collected and we head next door to the E-Lab to make graphs, analyze that data, and then make conclusions.
These next two videos are examples of what we did in the Discovery Lab. These are more examples of what we do in the Discovery Lab. This is an example of the kind of data we collect in a Discovery Lab.
We come over here to the E-Lab using the data from Discovery Lab to build the graph.
After we make the graph, we look at it, analyze it, and then we make a conclusion.
The End Downs Turkey by Jody Espinosa
and Haley Hernandez.
Hi, I'm Edie. I'm a Rio Grande turkey, and I live here at End Downs Elementary School. I'm here to teach you students about your environment. But I can also be very territorial. So go away. Sorry, I forgot to introduce my pet ninja chicken. Come on, little buddy, come on. Come on, little ninja chicken, come on.
Oh, I'm on camera?
I just said that. Chicken.
Oh, well, anyway, I'm Ninja Chicken, and I'm here to keep Edie calm.
Ninja Chicken, hey.
EdTV can be seen once a week. They usually update on the website on, I believe it's Monday, so every week you can see a new video of EdTV. And I'd like we have some of the kids from EdTV out here. If y'all would please stand up, let's give them a round of applause. They don't want to stand up. But thank you very much. I think we've taken long enough, and it's even farther past my bedtime now. So I'll turn it over to Mary Ellen.
Thank you, Mr. Moon. This time, the next showcase presentation is from Miller Jordan Middle School, Principal Mary Alice Martinez.
Mine is way past my bedtime, Tim. Good evening, Madam President, members of the board, Mr. Limon. My name is Mary Alice Martinez, and I am proud to say that I am the principal at Miller Jordan Middle School. Webster defines the word transformation as an act, a process, or instance of transforming or being transformed, which essentially means change. As the new campus principal at Miller Jordan Middle School, I am charged with leading the journey towards change, towards transformation. Let us take a glimpse at just a few things going on Miller Jordan Middle School, a school that is definitely on the move.
Hello, I'm Josh Jackson. I would like to welcome you to Miller Jordan Middle School. We all give that one extra degree in order to be successful. Our school houses approximately 100 employees and nearly 1,000 students in 6th, 7th, and 8th grades. Though Miller Jordan students come from various backgrounds, we all stand in common ground of achieving goals and dreams we have set for ourselves.
You are about to embark upon a journey where you will have the opportunity to see how we are on the right track, leading to achieving those goals and dreams. Hello, I'm Viviana Garza, an 8th grade student at Miller Jordan Middle School. Through engaging and cooperative learning, Miller Jordan students are acquiring skills to work together to become successful lifelong learners. With guidance from teachers and other adults at our school, the ability for us to be involved in various activities and the opportunity to be leaders among our peers, we are provided a learning environment to prepare us to live our lives in ways that will lead us to becoming effective and positive adults.
The Texas Education Agency is committed in assisting Miller Jordan Middle School in transforming our campus. This program offers us an unprecedented opportunity to make bold choices for a brighter future. Welcome, I'm Alfonso Resendez, TIPS Coordinator. Transformation is designed to increase student achievement by building capacity and changing our school culture. Building capacity and changing school culture is achieved through increasing the effectiveness of teachers and campus leaders, improving instruction through targeted professional development, creating a community-oriented school, and providing operational flexibility to our campus. Enjoy and come see what Miller Jordan is all about.
Jordan Middle School is also using quality data to drive our instructional decisions. I'm Patty Garcia with the Dean's Office. Our teachers have spent time training to learn the best methods of analyzing data in order to plan for teaching and learning in their classrooms. Along with this, teachers are working together in subject areas to make sure the curriculum is aligned across the grade levels.
The heat is on. The heat is on. The heat is on. Oh, it's on the street. The heat is on.
I think a leader should be able to make quick decisions and be able to just enforce, like, be able to keep his decision up. Like, if he was to tell someone to go do something, he should be able to stand by his decision and know that it was the right decision to do. I also think he should be a little more confident than other people would be, because if you show confidence, a lot of people will tend to gravitate to that and will tend to listen to you more.
I think a leader doesn't always have to know what they're doing. They just need to be able to make good decisions on their instincts.
I think a leader is a person who sets the example to help others, to encourage them, to try the best, and lead them forward.
I'm Jennifer Lamar, 8th grade math teacher at Miller Jordan. The importance of becoming strong leaders also plays a forefront at our campus for faculty, staff, and students. Professional development, various programs, and opportunities to show and use leadership skills are all a part of everyday life at Miller Jordan. Programs such as Gear Up for 8th grade students offers the opportunities to develop their leadership skills and prepare for their future. Master Teacher is a professional development program available for faculty and staff to use online to help develop skills as needed. Leadership roles are offered to staff and students as well, such as student body officers and associate principal positions for department leaders. Leadership skills are also demonstrated by staff members in various ways, such as modeling technology use for others, sharing information with coworkers, after attending professional development away from the campus, and conducting training in areas of expertise.
Utilizing every moment for learning is a must at Miller Jordan Middle School. I'm Octavio Salazar, 8th grade social studies teacher. In order to ensure students have the opportunity to learn all state mandated content, we are teaching in a variety of methods, including small group tutoring, educational field trips, and the use of technology such as iPads for teachers and students. Through interactive digital applications such as Edmodo, Google Docs, and Moodle, teachers have instant access to student work and students have immediate access to their assignments. Teachers are also embarking on the mission to flip their classroom by providing students with video embedded lessons for viewing on their iPads at home while completing what was once considered homework in class. Flipped Classroom provides students with immediate assistance and feedback from the teachers. Thank you. Feeling hot, hot.
Mi nombre es María Coronado. Soy una madre de un estudiante de la escuela de Miller Jordan. Creo que la participación de las familias es crucial para el éxito de sus estudiantes. Miller Georgian este año escolar ha proporcionado eventos emocionales para los estudiantes y sus familias, a participar en festivales y organización de otoño en octubre, que estuvo lleno de juegos, diversión, deliciosa comida y una casa embrujada espectacular. Los maestros y el personal de Miller Georgian también tuvieron reunión con los padres para la iniciativa de iPad. Los padres implican clases de inglés como segundo idioma y clases de ciudadanía. Los profesores, la directora, todos los que son las secretarias y organización de Miller Georgian son muy amables. Está a disposición antes y durante, después de las clases. Y si tienes alguna duda, sobre todo, ellos siempre están para ti. Aquí nos enseñan también cosas como para juntas, como para ir a las universidades con los niños, cuando uno tiene que aprender para ellos, para el colegio y para muchas cosas. Gracias.
Miller Georgian Middle School believes that family involvement is crucial to the success of their students. I am Janie Hernandez, a parent of an 8th grade MJMS student. This school year has provided exciting events for the students and their families to take part in. Miller Georgian hosted a fall festival in October that was filled with fun games, delicious food, and a spectacular haunted house. MJMS teachers and staff also had parent meetings for the iPad initiative. The faculty has made themselves available before, during, and after school to parents who have questions or concerns about iPads, iTunes accounts, tutoring, and gear up activities. Not only is my child important to Miller Georgian, I am as well.
Hi, I'm Nita Gonzalez, 8th grade student, Emily Jordan. It's important for students to want to be at school. Improving the school climate promotes an atmosphere that makes learning more enjoyable. In making improvements at our campus, more clubs are being created, more hands-on learning using technology is being placed in the classrooms, and more activities are being planned.
Faces.
you. And I would like to also introduce or acknowledge my staff. I have my two assistant principals, our TIPS coordinator, please stand. Come on, guys. Our dean of instruction, our instructional coach, and a couple of our associate principals. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Martinez. Great presentations. Stay tuned. Next month, Riverside and La Paloma are up. This is fun. Being a Star Wars fan, I just love it when the letters just disappear in the middle of the screen. Next item on the superintendent's report, we have disbursements by organization and the San Benito Consolidated Independent School District Investment Report for September the 1st, 2012 to November the 30th, 2012. So that concludes our superintendent's report. Would answer any questions that the board may have.
Thank you, Mr. Limon. Being that there are no questions, we'll move on to item number 7, roll call. Please respond with present. Ileana G. Rodriguez, president. Ms. Ana Cruz, vice president. Ms. June Aguilera, secretary.
Present.
Ms. Fatima Huerta, trustee.
Present.
Mr. Julian Huerta, trustee.
Present.
Mr. Hector G. Leal, trustee.
Present.
Mr. Oscar Medrano, trustee. Mr. Antonio G. Limon, superintendent of schools.
Present.
Mr. Juan Cabrera, attorney.
Present.
Item number 8, recommend approving the agenda of the regular board meeting of January 15, 2013 with any corrections or deletions.
So moved.
Motion made by Ms. Aguilera.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Leal. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Motion carries. Moving on to item number 9, public comment. We do have two individuals in the audience who would like to participate. The undersigned wish to address the San Benito CISD Board of Trustees and by his or her signature show into the board that he or she understands the following provisions to addressing the board. Persons wishing to address the Board of Trustees shall register with the presiding officer or designee no later than 5 minutes before the announced time of the school board meeting, shall state their full name, shall state what organization or group, if any, is being represented, shall state the topic they wish to address before the school board, shall refrain from commenting directly on any individual school district employee or public official by name, but may instead refer to a specific employment area, job title, or the Board of Trustees as a whole, and shall refrain from attacks on individuals. Persons wishing to address the Board of Trustees should do so in accordance with the following San Benito CISD Board Policy BED, Board Meetings Public Participation Guidelines. Speaker will be allowed only 5 minutes to give his or her presentation. Delegations of more than 5 persons shall appoint 1 person to present their views before the Board of Trustees. Presentations shall be informative and shall pertain to school-related issues. Any attack on an individual shall be considered disruption of the meeting, and the Board of Trustees shall not deliberate nor decide regarding any subject that is not included on the agenda posted with the notice of the meeting. This evening we do have Mr. John Hand, and his topic is thank you and school financing.
Thank you, Madam President, Superintendent Limon, members of the school board. My name is John Hand. I'm the president of the San Benito TSTA. And I'm here tonight for two things. First of all, I'd like to, because this is School Board Recognition Month, I'd like to thank you on the board for the efforts that you've given. While I'm talking, our staff member, Ms. Michaela Albujar Leon, is going to be passing out a brief handout that is kind of a quick and simple way of looking at the possibility of school financing. And I'll go over that in a second. Additionally, she also is going to be passing out a little gift to each of you as a token of our thanks for your service to the students of San Benito CISD this year. We know that when your phone rings at home in the evening, it isn't always somebody to call you and tell you what a great job you're doing. They probably have other reasons. So we also know that governance is difficult. It's very hard, and I think we've all learned that, and the only way we learn that is the hard way, unfortunately. It's never easy to run a business, run a school district, run a school, and your efforts are much appreciated by the members of our organization, and this is our way of saying thank you to you. I think tonight, from listening to the music that we heard, it's pretty obvious that if schools are cut, if school funds are cut and programs like this are cut, we're taking the heart and souls away from our students. These kids are realizing their dreams at an age when many of us who are older couldn't even have these dreams. And this is a wonderful gift that they have. And that's why tonight I'd like to briefly talk about the school cuts. A quick anecdote, I told this to Mr. Lamone, Ms. Sanchez. I was at a dinner. My daughter knows a gentleman who is involved with the NCLE leadership brief, which many of you get. And I was in Houston at a dinner. And this man who's worked for this company for several years out of Washington, D.C., and has moved to Houston was there. And he asked me where I lived. I said I lived in the valley and I teach in San Benito. He said, oh, San Benito, that's the place where the chess champions come from. I just want you to know that some of these things that we do here that cost us money and time and effort give us national recognition. And that's why it's important that we take a quick look at what is currently available to us if we'll just go and get it. As we know, if you have this pamphlet, and you're welcome to share this with anybody, we know that in the last 2 years, the cuts that the legislature imposed upon us have cost the state 25,000 jobs, including 11,000 teachers, and other cuts in our educational programs. What's interesting is that right now, our rainy day fund will soon total $11.8 billion, and state tax collections will exceed projections by $8.8 billion, giving the state over $20 billion to restore cuts to education and other state services. And so it's time for us to go and not only ask for, but demand that our cuts be restored and that we finance our schools and educate our children in a manner that's going to make them successful in their lives and make our state a better place to live in. And the other thing I'd like to mention is, excuse me, we're fortunate or blessed, however you want to say it, with legislators in South Texas who see things our way. But unfortunately, there are a lot of legislators in other parts of the state that don't see things our way. They're much more concerned with cutting money and spending it in other areas, or they're interested in charter schools. And let's all of us, whether you're in the audience or whether you're on the stage or whether you're me, if we know people in districts where there may be legislators that are teetering on the fence about cuts or no cuts, let's talk to our friends and relatives in those districts and start putting the heat on those legislators. Our legislators respond well to us and we communicate well with them, but there are a lot of legislators that need to understand how serious this is. And I hope that this little handout will kind of give all of us some talking points to bring to our meetings. And I want to thank you very much for your service to the district and thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Henn. We have another audience member who would like to share his thoughts, Tommy Ramirez, and his topic, partnership.
Good evening. I would like to, first of all, my first comment would be that the entertainment tonight was awesome. I've heard the groups before, it's been a while, and it just reminded me of what a great job the school district is doing with the fine arts. Secondly, I would like to just, as a resident of San Benito, I would like to say thank you to all of you for the hard work that you do as school board members. Having served myself for almost 12 years as a school board member in another district years ago, I understand and I appreciate the work and the effort that you guys put into what you do to make sure that our kids are being educated. And for that, I certainly appreciate you and I do thank you for that. I'm here tonight to speak on a special topic. I think most of you may have already seen it in the news or read it in one of the newspapers because it's been around quite a bit. And it's about the San Benito Boys and Girls Club. 10 years ago when I moved to this community, I joined the board of directors of the San Benito Boys and Girls Club. Having grown up in a boys club myself for many years and having been a professional of boys clubs for about 9 years, a long time ago, And having been a volunteer of Boys and Girls Clubs for over 30 years, I can appreciate what they do for our children. The past 10 years as a board member have been tough because we have seen the changes that have taken place with funding from United Way, from the city, from the state, from grants. I can recall back in 2004 that we were receiving approximately $102,000 from the city of San Benito. There were grants available. The United Way was providing about $70,000. The Boys Club was flourishing. We were able to provide all kinds of programs and activities for the San Benito kids. Since then, every year, those funds have declined most drastically from the city. This year, we've been pledged, yet to see any of it, but we've been pledged $9,000 from the city of San Benito. Our United Way funds have been reduced because of reduced pledges to approximately $30,000. The grants that we used to get have slowly gone away. Our most recent one that I applied for about 5 years ago, was through the COG for $56,000. And most recently, the governor's office rewrote the criteria for that grant, and we no longer could be eligible to apply. As a result of all these funding deficiencies, over the past 12 months, we've had to lay off almost all the staff. We have one staff member that's left. That's the director, Mario Cervantes, and the board members who constantly are selling barbecue plates and raffle tickets and golf tournaments, and people are just hiding when they see us because they know we're going to sell them something. And the funds that we raise from that are not big funds. Those funds were intended for things like Christmas parties for all the kids and Halloween parties, but we haven't been able to really do that because we're needing those funds to pay the utility bill, the insurances on the program and the facility, etc. I went to the city of San Benito about a week ago, basically begging them to help us keep the club open because we're about down to about 120 days of operational funds. The only reason the club is even open today is because about 12, 13, 14 months ago, I received a grant through my department. I'm the chief of the Juvenile Justice Department here in Cameron County. That grant was a early prevention grant, originally intended for me to use at the Harlingen Outreach Center, a facility that I created in partnership with the city of Harlingen and the school district. When I realized that the Boys Club was in jeopardy at that time and that we needed to do something, I wrote an amendment to my grant requesting the state to allow me to move that grant to the San Benito Boys and Girls Club because I knew it would buy me some time to keep the club running, serve the kids, and give us some time to figure out where we could get some resources to keep the club open indefinitely. Well, we just haven't had a lot of luck. The city's response last week was that they're going to put a committee together and look at how they could possibly help us. I'm here tonight because we have several hundred kids that are Boys and Girls Club members of San Benito Boys Club. From your community, your children, your students. On a daily basis, we get approximately 70 to 75 kids from the schools immediately surrounding the club. And those parents and those kids, they love the Boys and Girls Club. We provide after-school tutoring, mentoring, getting them ready for tests, book club, arts and crafts, recreation, social events, basketball, football, and the list just goes on and on, wellness programs. When the kids found out that there's a likelihood that in 120 days it would be closed, they became very sad. They're sort of devastated, really. The parents are devastated. A lot of these folks cannot afford because of the jobs that they have that doesn't really pay them the money that gives them the ability to go pay a daycare the money that they require. So I'm not sure what they're going to do. But I'm here tonight because, as I entitled my request, to talk about a partnership. I've been in this Boys Club stuff for over 30-something years. I know that all over the place in other communities, the reasons that Boys Clubs can exist and provide the hundreds and hundreds of thousands of kids that are provided services is because the school district, the city, the community, the people, they come together and everyone participates through some method of contribution. And that's how Boys Clubs exist. Those Boys Clubs that are flourishing extremely well, it's all because those partnerships are great. Right now, we are in dire need of the community, the city, the school district, for all of us to come together and be willing to step up and be a part of the solution of this serious problem. I was talking to my wife, and she says, "Why are you putting all this stress on yourself? We don't have any kids here. They're all out of college and living somewhere else and have their own lives. These kids aren't yours." Well, yeah, they are. They are my kids. As long as I live in this community, I take ownership and I take responsibility for those kids. The hundreds of kids that we serve there in all kinds of ways, those are my kids. So if we are not able to keep the club open, I will know that I tried everything humanly possible to keep it open. And maybe it's not in its destiny to be open, I don't know. We'll soon find out. I'm just asking you to please come together, just as I asked the city, look into the possibilities of being a partner somehow to keep the club open. We're asking for $75,000, the core basic amount of money to keep the doors open on that club. I look at that myself through my department. I have invested $150,000 to $175,000 out of my budget through my grants, through my programs, because it's that important to me. Now, what'll happen if it closes? I simply take all of my staff and all the things that we're doing there, and we move to Harlingen and provide services to the kids in Harlingen. But I already have a program going on over there. I already have a partnership with the city and the school. I really would like to see the San Benito Boys and Girls Club keep those doors open for all those kids that need that safe place to come to every day after school and all summer long, when we serve 200 to 225 kids daily through programs, through meals, and all the things that these kids need, just as you showed on those videos, to become good citizens of this community. I thank you for your time, and again, I congratulate you, and to tell you that I appreciate your hard work, Mr. Limon. I appreciate all the work that we do together to serve the kids in this community. God bless you, and good night.
Thank you. Okay, that brings us to item number 10, action agenda. The items that will be mentioned in the next few minutes require a consent agenda and a consent from the board. Under business and finance, we have 1301A-1, request for approval of bid proposals pertinent to the Universal Service Fund Education Rate, E-Rate 16, year 2013. Question? 1301A-2, presentation and discussion or action on Pink Ape Media on school bus advertising.
Could be a question, because I'm going to make a presentation.
That item will also be questioned. There's a presentation to follow. Item 1301A-3, request for approval of 2012-2013 budget amendments. Consent. Item 1301A-4, request for approval of budget transfers. Consent. Under Curriculum and Instruction, 1301A-5, request for approval of PB Moss School Improvement Plan 2012-2013. Consent. Under Administration, 1301A-6, request for approval of board minutes. Consent. 1301A-7, request for approval of resolution of to suspend portions of policy EIA local for the 2012-2013 school year only. Consent. I'd like to ask for a motion to accept item 1301A-3, 1301A-4, 1301A-5, 1301A-6, and 1301A-7.
So moved.
Motion made by Ms. Aguilera. Seconded by Ms. Huerta. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Motion carries. Going back to those items in question, item 1301A-1, request for approval of bid proposals pertinent to the Universal Service Fund Education Rate, E-Rate 16, year 2013. On that one, I'd like to ask that the board consider approving the E-Rate as presented and with those recommendations made by Mr. Tanasia, with the exception of Form G. I ask that we accept the recommendations for the first, second, and third bids proposed.
I'll make a motion.
Okay.
So moved.
Motion made by Ms. Aguilera, seconded by Mr. Huerta. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Item 1301A-2, presentation, discussion, action on Pink 8 Media on school bus advertising, and I believe we have a presentation this evening.
Good evening, Madam Chair, Superintendent Limon, members of the board. My name is Rodrigo Moreno. I represent Pink 8 Media Consulting. This is Mr. Carlos Pacheco, my CEO. And we would like to share with you a presentation that is a very short presentation that we prepared for you. We were talking about that in 2011, legislation was passed where the school buses now for the districts are allowed to put advertised on their sides and on the top part of the buses. This is because of the constant budget cuts that the district charters have experienced this past couple of years, right? So the law is pretty simple. It states a little bit about the placement, where you can put an ad. It's on the first placement is on the lower left side of the bus, which is the one that I'm showing right now. And then it allows you to put on the top part of the bus, which is where the subway ad is right there. You can put it on the left side or on the right side of the bus. The dimensions of this on the rear left is 90 inches by 30 inches, and on the top part it's 108 inches by 18 inches. The materials that we have to use are the ones that can last for about a year, which is the contract that most of the clients sign with us. And if it's removed, we have to leave the surface of the bus as the way it is, the way it was when we got to them. We cannot use brackets or hardware. This is just by state law. That means that it has to be a plain surface without any things sticking out of the side of the bus. Now, all of the advertisement that we place on the buses has to be approved by your district, which means that we're not, of course, there's no alcohol, tobacco, religion, political signs, but we're also going to submit to you the proposals of every client and see if you are aware of that business and if you would like to see it on a San Benito school bus. Why hire a private firm? First of all, there's no initial cost for the district. You don't have to have an office where you have to set up people to advertise or to find clients. You can have a focus team. Some of the districts that tried to do this by their own efforts find out that the people that they have there, they're not so focused on selling advertisement. They have to do other work that the district requires. So it's not as effective as having a salespeople dedicated to this type of effort. Now, we in PK Media, we already have the contract for the Brownsville Independent School District. We are in the process of filling out those 300 buses that the district has. That means we're already talking with clients. Sometimes we go there and they ask us, where else do you have the contract? Where else can we put advertisement? There's several of our clients that have asked us that question. And we're the only thing that we're saying right now, we're talking to San Benito, maybe they are interested also on them. We already have clients, we have experience in advertisement, which is a huge plus when you're trying to do this type of deals. What do we offer as a company? What do we offer the district? Well, first of all, we offer a tailor-made contract, which is you guys can put the rules of this game. You can tell us this is what we want to do. We can show you the contract that we have in other places, so you can see and you have some sort of a guide where you can find out if it fits for you or not. We offer 50% of the profits. Every money that comes here minus expenses, it's 50% for the district. We are open for audits. Anytime that you want to come to our office and see what the book says, how many clients that we have, how many people have we sold advertisement, you are more welcome to come and see our books. We can offer you a monthly or a yearly payment, 6 months, 3 months, whatever you decide to do, whatever you feel more comfortable with doing that. We are open for that. We are going to set up a marketing office. We already have a marketing office, like I said, dedicated to this project. We have a sales force that is going to be calling clients. It's going to be delivering ads or delivering the projects. And we're also going to print, of course, promotional materials like your Ad Here campaign, which is on the side of the bus. We wanted to put a vinyl that says, this is help our children get a better education. Buy this ad from us. Call this number. So people can be aware that the district is now doing that and they can utilize this media. We are also going to have a payment collection department, which is essential to this type of business because every month you have to be on top of every client, making sure that everybody's on time, and then we are collecting, right? We are also offering the printing and then the installation of the advertisements.
So the district would only get 50% of the profits to come
in? Yes, ma'am. Yeah, that's what we offer. Most of the time it's only 25 to 35%. We offer 50% of the profit, which is you don't have to set up an office. You don't have to commit your people to doing this. We already have people. We have an office. We have all those type of expenses that you don't have to run into those. Yeah. This is a table that we prepared so you can see how this is working or how do we foresee the project going on San Benito. We started January, which is already, we have half a month already there, but we put January, which is, we think we can get 10 clients real quick to advertise here. The same on February, March, we're thinking of 20, and then we go increments. In April 25, in May 30, June 40, July 40, August, since it's the summer and not all of the buses are running out, we're thinking about 10 buses only. September, we'll go back to 50, October 60, November 65, and December 80, which I think it's the number of buses that the district has. Now, this gives us revenue for 5, 10, 12, all the way to $40,000 a month, which is half of that would be the San Benito School District, which would be $20,000 minus expenses. In this fiscal year, since we're already half of it, we're figuring between $25,000 to $30,000 till the end of this school year that you already have. So it's a number like that. And to finalize this, is we wanted to remind you, we want to make a new way to generate funds. I just saw the gentleman here talking about funding, talking about how we can get more revenue for district. This is a good way to do it. It can grow as much as we can. I mean, we can, like I said, the last month was 40,000. We can 40,000 divided to 12 months. It's a good amount of money that the district might have in the future, but it has to be started. It has to be worked until we get to that goal. We are professionals at this. We already know what we're doing. We already have the clients. The clients trust us, and they're going to advertise in another school district. Why not in San Benito? We have the experience of doing all of this. And at the end of this fiscal year, you can get a little bit money from our way of doing business. And that's it. Thank you so much.
Is this a yearly agreement or contract? Or?
Well, the way that we have it in all school districts is the first year, it's a yearly contract, and then at the end of the year, we can renew it for 2 more years. That's the way we've done it, for example, in Bronzeville. Okay. But the first year, it's just 1 year, and then we can renew it for another additional 2 years. Okay. But it's up to you, however you want to do it. We're sure of the results. We know that we can do a good job, so I don't see why not getting a little bit more time.
Did we have our legal counsel go over the contract, or?
I requested a contract, but I do give it to Mr. Cabrera, but I don't remember getting it.
We talked to BISD, and the legal department is reviewing it at this point. They don't want to give it away at this point, but we're working on that. In the next couple of days, we should have it so you can review.
Well, we don't want to see their contract. We just want to see your standard form contract.
Yeah, we can provide you that. Like I said, I put it on the presentation. We're going to go with you. You're going to redact the contract, and we're open for whatever. Of course, reasonable. We're open to be able to work with you guys. I mean, it's not a problem with us because it's a simple one. It's practically none. But like I said, we work with you.
But your standard is 50-50.
Yes.
So that's, well, I understand the amount of work that it goes into to wrap an automobile, especially a bus. My father does that too.
Oh, okay.
But my only thing is, we're going to pay you to advertise on our buses, which we fuel and which goes around. So it's like we're paying them to advertise on our buses. And we're not making, we're going to make money, but we still have to split it half and half. And like I said, I know how much work goes into it, but I mean, we're paying for the gas that's going to be on it. Our buses are the ones that are going to be going out in town, and we're the reason that they're going to get business, and then we have to pay them and get split. So that's the only thing that I have.
And not only that, I think it's after the 50% is minus expenses, correct?
Yeah, that's basically the commission.
My family does that, and I know how much wrapping costs. And I know the things that can occur with it. So
the wrapping for the buses, it's not an expense that the district is going to pay. The client pays for that. For example, one of the clients is going to be $300 for the bus. That's a different cost, and it's going to be deducted from the 50% that you are going to make from.
What is going to be deducted after the expense?
It could be a sales commission for a sales vendor. There's between one of the clients are the first month of the contract. If they get a year contract, they get half of that half of that month as a commission. So that could be deducted from cost. Like I said, we already have an office, we have a sales team, we have our phone systems and everything. You don't have to invest in that. We already provide in that type of investment.
But the money that we have, that we pay, it's going to be to pay your employees, the ones that you have.
No, the employees.
Just the commission. Just the commission.
Yeah. Exactly, yes. And that's because a sales has to work based on commission. If you start giving them salaries and stuff like that, you don't work like that with them. But it's commission and stuff, minor stuff that you have to, there's something have to be done with that, yes.
Okay, if I understand this correctly, this is money, the district is not out a penny.
No.
This is money that you're going to go out and sell for advertisement.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so whether our buses are going to run regardless whether they have your logo on them or not, or
yes,
the
sir.
Logo of the sponsor on them.
Yes.
Okay. But whatever comes in, we get 50%
yes.
of what your company sells.
Yes, minus the commissions and the expenses.
Okay. So we get 50%
after the commissions
after you deduct the expenses.
Yes, sir.
And those projections that you were basing of, I think you had what, 70,000 for the first year, something like that?
For the first year, which is, we have a different fiscal year from us, it's from January to December, but we have to change it because your your school budget system. It allows you just from November, I think, to October.
Okay, but we're not getting involved in any of the selling.
No, sir.
We're not responsible for any of the selling. We're not liable for anything. You will abide by whatever rules are there, mm-hmm. and whatever contract has to be approved by our attorney before we go into it.
Yeah.
We're not going to lose a penny in this business.
No, sir. Nothing. No.
And we'll make whatever, the more you hustle, the more we make.
Exactly. That's what the benefits of hiring a private firm, you already have the clients. If the district wants to get this involved and do it themselves, they have to get the clients. You're going to invest a lot of money trying to get the advertisers. You got to add, you got to have somebody that knows how to do the artwork and everything, and get the advertiser. Our firms already has 6 years involved in this, and they know the clients. They already have. We just need to tell them you can do it in San Benito also. That's the difference between hiring a private firm than do it by yourselves.
Mr. Lamont, I think you mentioned you'd spoken to them earlier, and I missed the presentation. I apologize. Was there any limitations you wanted to have in terms of selection of advertisers, or was the idea that they were just going to select them within a...
They have to meet the guidelines. The law is specific.
The guidelines, right? From the legislature.
Yes.
From the legislature is specific as to who can advertise on the
bus. But within that, there's still classes, so I just didn't know if you wanted to.
Well, I think you were going to allow us to have the final approval on those or not?
Yes, of course. Yes.
Okay.
Ads, that'll be part of the contract.
All right, we'll do that.
Come up with.
Yeah, it's part of the contract, yes. Any more questions?
So are we going to vote for this tonight? Or?
It says discussion, possible action on whether the board wants to do it or not.
I make a motion that we, considering that the legal counsel has to view the contract and that there's no liabilities as far as the district, I think it's a good idea for us to make some extra money. Our buses have to run anyway, so might as well, you know.
As long as it doesn't cost us
consider,
a penny.
We can maybe try it for a year. It works out for us, as long as legal counsel tells us that the contract is fine.
Yeah, it's vital that we get a contract worked out,
of course,
as the motion states, you know, to the satisfaction of our law firm.
Of course.
Okay.
I'll second it.
Okay, I have a motion on the floor by Mr. Leal, seconded by Mr. Huerta. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you. We'll do a good job.
Thank you. Item number 11, closed meeting, discussion under the authority of the Texas Government Code 551.071 for the purpose of a private consultation with the board's attorney on any or all subjects or matters authorized by law. A, review of HCA medical clinic audit payment dispute. B, review of medical billing contract 551.074 for the purpose of the appointment, employment, evaluation, reassignment, duties, discipline, or dismissal of a public officer or employee to hear complaints or charges against a public officer or employee. A, employment of contract personnel, resignation, and retirement. 551.072 for the purpose of discussing the purchase, exchange, lease, or value of real property. A, review, discussion regarding bids received for property struck off to Cameron County for itself and other taxing jurisdictions for a tax sale conducted on November 6, 2012. 1, Tract 1, Lot 2, Block 38, original town site, City of San Benito, Cameron County, Texas, as described in Volume 14334, page 272, Official Records of Cameron County, Texas, account number 57-0000-0380-0020-000. Lot number 2, Lot 67, La Alameda subdivision, an addition to the City of San Benito, Cameron County, Texas, according to the map or plat thereof, recorded in Cabinet 1, Slide 454B, Map Records of Cameron County, Texas, account number 59-3000-0000-0670-00. Number 3, 0.51 acres, more or less, being a portion of Block 127, San Benito Land and Water Company Subdivision, Cameron County, Texas, as described in deed dated June 2nd, 2004. From Chase Manhattan Mortgage Corporation to Guadalupe V. Olivares in Volume 10300, page 200, Official Records of Cameron County, Texas, account number 61-0820-1270-00. Number 4, 2.528 acres, more or less, being a portion of Lot 15, Los Ranchos Subdivision, Cameron County, Texas, as described in deed dated May 28,
2006.
I believe it's 2006, from Manuel Longoria E-Tex to Romualdo Morales Gomez in volume 3978, page 218, official records of Cameron County, Texas, account number 88-2500-0150-0010-00. The time is now 9:18 and we are in closed session. The time is now 11:36 and we are reconvening from closed session. We're now in open meeting. Mr. Limon, item A, employment of contract personnel, resignation and retirement.
Madam President, I'm asking that the employment of routine personnel is discussed in executive session, a retirement and resignations be approved.
I'll make a motion to go with a recommendation with the superintendent.
A second.
Motion made by Mr. Huerta, seconded by Ms. Aguilera. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Item B, discussion and possible action on HCA medical clinic audit payment dispute, no action. Item C, discussion and possible action of medical billing contract, no action. Item D, discussion and possible action on the resolutions approving the bids received in the tax sale conducted on November 5th, 2012.
I'd like to make a motion to accept the bids received on the tax sale conducted on November 5th, 2012. I'll second.
I have a motion to accept the bids received on tax sale conducted on November 5th by Ms. Huerta, seconded by Ms. Aguilera. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. The time is now 11:38 and we are adjourned.